knowing any Spanish or Spanish language. So in high school, I ended up taking a lot of honors courses, some technology courses, some graphic courses, and that sort of thing, which I'm sure most of you encourage your students to do so. So being a first generation student, I started college at a community college. So I had prepared myself kind of a yoga 4 years ago, but I didn't really do it. And that was just for a combination of reasons, where just either kind of the cultural aspect or going away to school wasn't as common. So I ended up taking business, graphics, accounting, that sort of thing. But eventually ended up doing an associate in arts and associate in science. And at the end of my community college experience, I wanted to do something that was a do-good future. It was more a sustainability-driven interest in environmental behavior. So I ended up at the University of North Carolina at Charlotte, and that's where I started my PS. I was able to do research in one of our concrete labs. I worked with geopolymer cement concrete, which is actually a concrete with no portable cement, which should be shocking. With no Portland. So concrete is typically Portland cement concrete. It's what makes a binder and makes it become concrete, yes. So geopolymer cement concrete actually uses fly ash, which does anyone know where fly ash comes from? So ashes are a coal combustion byproduct. So we're burning coal to make energy, and we have all this residue, all this fly ash left over. And I'm sure you can imagine that we have a lot of it all over the country. And so it's just stockpiled. And if you follow current events, you'll find that in North Carolina, for example, caught out of it because it had fly ash spilled into one of the waterways, which contaminated water, killed a lot of fish, and that sort of thing. So it's kind of a bad substance. So what we were actually doing was putting it in concrete. So that was one of the opportunities that I was able to, that I was given at UC Charlotte. And on top of that, I was also involved with engineers without borders, which is one of the things that I want to focus on. The university provided an engineering for development workers study abroad. And I'll touch a little more on that in the next slide. But I finished up at UNC Charlotte with an MS, just continuing the work with geopolymers and concrete. So the engineering for development workers, this is a bit of a side of engineering that you don't really see a lot of times, because typically when you say engineering to someone, what do they mean? Where are they working?
In an office.
In an office. Mm-hmm. Anywhere else? Like, where do they sit?
So they're still on here outside.
So one of the, in terms of this, development work is a side of engineering that engineers can go into developing countries and work on projects that typically are easy for us, but maybe this community or something has a need for this. Other organizations like Engineers Without Borders, they are an international organization that provides technical skills to fix either sanitation problems or water distribution problems in communities that ask for that. And so our project was to replace this bridge, which this was in a little village called Five Tribes. And it was up by the Andes, and every year they would have that. I think it's really important for younger students to see science and math doesn't have to be scary. There is a chance to connect that social aspect of it, which a lot of times you can see very easily in medical careers. You become a nurse and you help someone. So service learning in STEM tries to recast STEM careers as more socially engaging. It changes the impression of the STEM career, so it makes it a more positive impression, so that we're not just thinking that we're going to go work in an office. There's a chance to provide your technical skills to change the world, if you will. It also tends to make it a little more enticing to first and family students, or students that don't necessarily see themselves in that. You know, have to get your master's, your PhD, and that sort of thing. So it tends to build a social capital between the students and the engineers that are practicing, because a lot of times that you're working together. And it tends to increase your interpersonal skills, which is always a positive thing. Do you have any questions on that? Now I'm more immersed in engineering and kind of what I do on a regular basis. These are all the things that I think I use every day. I'm working usually with 3 or 4 different people, emailing managers about project updates, all that sort of thing. And these are the same tools that you start having groundwork in middle school and high school that you develop in college and practice in your career. Those are key. And I'll get into a little bit of bridge engineering, what used to be done, what's being done now, and what we're looking at in the future. Does anyone know when we started kind of having a transportation development boom? Do it. big things is with the residential to urban is we have core volume of vehicles and we have TEP of vehicles, which play into how the bridge is designed. And so if a bridge was designed over 50 years ago for those volumes and we have it in use today for these volumes, a lot of times that's where we start to see problems when they're getting old and they're not being used how they're meant to be used. So because of that, a bridge that's 50 some years old should have seen a bunch of inspections and probably more frequently in the last couple of years. A lot of times what we end up finding on inspections, typical stuff, is concrete cracking, concrete spalling, which is just get your exposed rock in the concrete. You have steel that is rusting, very common. You have joints, so one of the things that I was on the slides is a bridge is jointed. So it has two different slabs. When you're traveling on it, you'll typically change from asphalt to concrete. You can feel that too when you're driving, unless the bridge is covered in asphalt. But there is a joint between one part of the bridge and the next part of the bridge. They typically find that point up here, above here. So that's the picture there. So once we find these things wrong, that are wrong with the bridge, then they require maintenance. So your concrete cracks would typically go in, take out that section of concrete, and replace it with new concrete. Your steel, you'll probably paint it. And just recoat it. Your joints, if you start to tear, a lot of times you'll have water under the bridge, which is a little worse because you end up having more problems under the bridge. And so these happen to repair as well. And at some point, once the bridge gets really old, you start finding things like this, which is rebar that gets exposed, and this is really bad. This is, you're starting to see failure in certain parts of certain elements. Now, this bridge probably wouldn't fall or anything like that because one element is the whole thing. But then you start considering, okay, will the bridge be rehabilitated or will we do a new bridge? And those choices typically get made where what's going to cost less? Is it going to cost more to repair it for a couple of years, or is it going to cost less of the same thing?
What bridge is it?
Can't say.
For a living. It's the video you couldn't get enough of on NBCDFW.com. Tonight we are hearing from the folks who dangle hundreds of feet in the air for a living. It's the video you couldn't get enough of. NBCDFW.com. They are bridge inspectors at the top of the Margaret Hunt Hill Bridge. Channel 5 got them on video, and Ray Vieta spoke to them tonight. Ray chose to be live on the ground. He joins us now. Ray.
Yeah, Meredith, unlike those inspectors, I actually do have a fear of heights. And that's the first question I asked them. Do you ever get afraid being up there? Keep in mind, it's 450 feet up in the sky at the top of that bridge. They told me they've been doing this for years, but it still takes a little bit of getting used to.
And you get used to these unusual situations.
From up above, chopper men at work inspecting the Margaret Hunt Hill Bridge in Dallas.
I would love to say I'm always used at any height, but you always, that very first look, they go, okay, this is where I am, and this is where I'm working this week.
Each person has a specific job. The two UC sitting right there, legs dangling, work specifically with ropes, the cables the inspectors use to work their way down the bridge. In the center was Peter Harrison, supervising it all.
So you had the two gentlemen beside me who were managing where the ropes were, but my job was to make sure that there wasn't any damage to the rope during their actual work.
In order to get to the top of the bridge, the inspectors have to climb these platforms. I'm on platform one, Matt's headed towards platform two. There are a total of 30 to get to the top of the bridge overlooking Dallas.
On the first day, with all the gear that we had to haul up there, about 600 pounds or so, it took about an hour and a half.
After making the climb up the platforms, they arrange a system of cables that help them suspend in the air, getting a look at the bridge up close.
And we got a camera and a notepad here and a pen, so you're pretty much hands-free the entire time while we're suspended from ropes, so we can do all this stuff and document.
The group tells us these bridge checkups are all very similar, no matter how tall, how high up in the sky they are.
It doesn't really faze me too much, I guess. I like heights.
And he's obviously not the only one, since he saw there were so many folks working with him. We're told they do this rain or shine. And if you're wondering why this bridge is getting checked up since it's relatively young, we're told it's just a routine checkup mandated by the federal government. We're live in Dallas tonight. I'm Ray Vieta, NBC 5.
All right. Thank you. Yeah.
Materials, it's different types of materials, so I'm going to look at carbon fiber. I've pretty landscapes on the sides of them. So those kinds of things are going to be incorporated. Another quick one, I have another video at the end, is the accelerated bridge construction. So how many times have you been driving down the road and suddenly one of the lanes has been taken out? Otherwise it would be over. Or your bridge that you used to cross is now gone, so you have to take a different route. Accelerated bridge construction methods are trying to design bridges and construct them overnight or in minimal time. So it's a process to speed that up and make it more efficient and cheaper. And what's driving these things? Why are we changing? Why are we trying to improve these techniques? One, we have mechanical materials, we have higher performing materials also over our existing stuff. Designs are becoming more efficient, they're reducing maintenance, and they're increasing the lifespan. And the sustainability aspect as well. So you have a lot of younger engineers that feel that the environment is important. So those things are changing. And I guess you would say millennials, and I'm not sure what the generation after millennials is called. Those groups are coming into the field, and they're changing the way things are done. So, some resources for you guys to use in your classes, specifically with Virginia. So, VDOT provides a really nice website. I had to check every single state's website. A couple of months back, and VDOT is one of the nicest ones. They provide a lot of information. And they have a site called Virginia Roads, which you can go on it, and they have different maps. You can find every bridge in the state. You can check when the bridge was built. You can check what the bridge is rated. You can find every trail, cycling trail, walking trail in the state. You can track project locations if something pops up down the road and you can check out this or not. And the prices and things of this project. So definitely check out their website. This is a screenshot of their bridge website. So I use this a lot typically whenever we're going out to do inspections. It's preliminary information to find out where your bridge is, what it's rated, and stuff. And it's really, really user-friendly too. Other resources is reaching out to your local engineering organizations. These organizations are local for outreach, that's their purpose. One of it is professional development for engineering, but the other side is engineering, trying to get people into engineering. So one of the big ones for civil engineering is the American Society of Civil Engineers. And they produce the infrastructure report card. Who has heard of the infrastructure report card? No? Little? What about in the election? No ratings or the report card, the U.S. is failing? No? Okay. Well, it comes up a lot. Especially the American Society of Civil Engineers rates everything, all of our infrastructure, and they provide it on this website, and you can go into each state and find out what your ratings are, and you can also see the brief description and know why is that the case, and what they're also doing to kind of improve their ratings. And the other big thing about organizations like this is that they provide free handouts, free project ideas for pre-college, for middle school, for elementary school, for high school. And anytime that maybe, most of the time these things are free to access for anyone, but anytime that there's, you know, a membership access that you have to have, you can reach out to whoever is in the local chapter, and I'm sure they're doing what they're willing to give to you. So other groups that I mentioned before, engineers collaborators, where chapter engineers, water people provide water internationally, plus engineers. applying engineering skills to take it outside of the office or outside of the I just have to go make money sort of thing. So, path to STEM, high school. I think the biggest thing is mentors. So, connecting to those and that sort of thing. Obviously, the different courses, doing with college. And one of the benefits of a civil engineering degree, actually, is that I wouldn't say that for all engineering degrees, I guess. You get your cognitive skills, your inductive reasoning skills, which transfer to any, really, just about any. And you also, it's one of the few careers that you can pick off a career with a 4-year degree. A lot of times civil engineers don't get their master's. It's pretty rare, actually. So, in class activities, I would say just promoting the projects where housing is visualizing. One of the biggest things that I do on a regular basis is trying to visualize things. It's a little hard sometimes, so starting those skills off early on. And I encourage your students to investigate buildings around them. Every building has a history. You know, when was it built? Why is it built differently than it would be today? That's what I'm more gracious. So, again, just reaching out to the different chapters of the building companies. Typically, any office. There's a lot of engineering offices in this area. Somebody will volunteer to come out to your class and talk or come in and judge some sort of competition and provide those kind of resources. Sometimes it gets a little hectic with schedules and things, but typically you'll find one person has an office that can handle it. ASCE does a Engineers Week in February of every year. Whole week kind of dedicated to celebrating engineering. But one of the biggest things is the outreach that we do, including Introducing Girls to Engineering Day. And I think that's also very important because we don't have a lot of girls in engineering. In fact, I'm the only girl on my team. So, and going through college, it was kind of a 10% number. So that's important too. ASCE will be releasing a movie kind of highlighting big engineer projects of doing big. The local ASCE chapter, I sit on their board, and so they're looking to have one of the IMAX theaters, or a couple IMAX theaters, show the movie so that we can reach out to schools and have kids watch this. That's the situation. So, I have two handouts. One handout was I'm gonna bring it up for everybody so you guys are doing PDFs. One list was some project ideas, the different organizations in the area. So additional ones are Society of Hispanic Professional Engineers, the National Society of Black Engineers, the Society of Women Engineers. And a big one in this area is also Virginia Society of Professional Engineers. And they kind of serve as a governing body to connect to the other organizations. And some of the service learning and STEM topics, there's been some studies on trying to see what would encourage minority students to pursue STEM or stay in STEM. So I've included this on the bibliography of that. The other handout was an activity for a hydraulic ramp. Does anyone know what that is? Hydraulic ramp.